Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles taken up for today's analysis, along with the respective page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi, and Thiruvananthapuram editions. The handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of all the news articles taken up for today's analysis will be available in the description section and also in the comment section below for the benefit of the smartphone users. Let us now start our analysis. First, let us see the editorial title, Reimagining the Niti Aayog. The analysis of this editorial will be helpful in your mains preparation in your General Studies Paper 2 under Functions and Responsibilities of the Union and the States, Issues and Challenges Pertaining to the Federal Structure, Devolution of Powers and Finances up to Local Levels and Challenges therein. And also in your General Studies Paper 3 under Indian Economy and Issues Related to Growth. First, the authors have started with the fact that the Indian economy, polity and demography, that is the population and the Indian society, has undergone many changes since independence. The authors have suggested that India's fiscal federalism needs to be reconsidered from a different perspective, and they have proposed four pillars for redesigning India's fiscal federalism. So this entire editorial is about these four pillars for redesigning India's fiscal federalism. We know that politically federalism means a division of powers between the central government and different state governments. So the power is divided between the center and the states. Now fiscal means something which is related to the revenue or the finances. So we can tell fiscal federalism as the division of financial powers. Now let us see the first pillar that has been proposed by the authors. It is the Finance Commission. To know why Finance Commission's role is important, you first need to know the imbalances in the financial federal structure. The authors tell that typically countries that have financial federalism have two types of imbalances. One is the vertical imbalance and the other is horizontal imbalance. First, let us see the vertical imbalance. Vertical means central government at the top or the helm and the state governments at the next level. Now, if the tax revenues have to be shared between the state and the center. If center gets more tax revenues than the state governments, then we can tell that there is a vertical imbalance. The authors tell that the constitution mandates relatively greater responsibilities to the state governments when compared to the central government. If you see post the introduction of GST, nothing but the goods and service tax, the share of states in the public expenditure is 60%, while it is 40% for the center to perform their duties as mentioned in the constitution. So we can see that there is some balance achieved with the introduction of this GST. Now, horizontal imbalance means the imbalance between the different state governments in the India, which is nothing but this layer. Even though the money shared to all the state governments may be the same, few states may have more challenges because of its population. So they have different level of development. The authors tell that traditionally the finance commissions have dealt with these imbalances in a very good manner. So, the authors proposed that the Finance Commission should continue to be the first pillar of the new fiscal federal structure of India. That is why, or this is the importance of the Finance Commission which the authors put forward. Now, we have discussed about Finance Commission in our 9th May analysis. Just have a look at it. Next, to propose the second pillar, the authors have tried to explain further the horizontal imbalance that we just saw. They tell that this horizontal imbalance has two more types again, type 1 and type 2. Now, if this type 1 imbalance is more about providing adequate basic public goods and services between different states, while type 2 imbalance is about transformational capital deficits. We know that India is growing, but at the same time, the infrastructure also needs to grow. Now, to build the infrastructure, you need some money, which is nothing but your capital. If you get less money in the form of investments than the money which you require to build this infrastructure, then you can call this as transformational capital deficit in simpler terms. So we can tell one activity is dependent on the other here. So the authors mention that this type 2 horizontal imbalance is known to be historically condition or path dependent, which means depending on one or other parameters. So, to address these type 1 and type 2 horizontal imbalances, the authors tell that the Tinbergen assignment principle should be followed. Now, according to this principle, the policymakers trying to achieve multiple economic targets need to have control over at least one policy tool for each policy target. So, for one goal, you at least need to have one policy tool. Now, to address this type 1 horizontal imbalance, the authors have proposed the Finance Commission, which is the first pillar that we just saw. And to address this type 2 horizontal imbalance, the authors have proposed Niti Aayog version 2. So, the authors proposed this Niti Aayog version 2 as the second pillar of new fiscal federal structure. The authors tell that in the past, the Planning Commission used to give grants to the states as conditional transfers using the Gadgil-Mukherjee formula. Now, just remember this formula name. It need not be seen in detail since the Planning Commission has been scrapped by the present government. So, these conditional transfers helped the state governments in the past to address their development issues. Now, some can argue that the Finance Ministry is the other alternative to the Planning Commission or to what Planning Commission did in this regard, but the authors tell that the Finance Ministry's primary duty is to focus on the country's macroeconomic stability and the proper functioning of the financial system instead of focusing on the development of the states. Now, this is the reason why the authors are telling that the Finance Commission can address this type 1 horizontal imbalance and Niti Aayog version 2 can address this type 2 horizontal imbalance. But we know that Niti Aayog is just a think tank of the government and it has no financial powers. So, the authors have suggested that the newer version or the second version of Niti Aayog should receive significant resources, say 1% to 2% of the entire GDP to address the type 2 horizontal imbalance. In short, it should be given some financial powers. If Niti Aayog will focus on giving the money to the states, it will promote the growth of the states that are lagging and help overcome their historically conditioned infrastructure deficit, thus reducing their development imbalance. The authors also add that Niti Aayog should be mandated to create an independent evaluation office to manage these grants that they give to the states in the future. Next, the authors propose decentralization to be the third pillar of the new fiscal federal structure. Now, we have three tiers of government: the center, then the state governments, and then the local governments. The authors propose to create a consolidated fund for the local government since the regional imbalances within the states are very higher, and also to honor the local governments such as the panchayats and the municipalities, which enjoy the constitutional status as per the 73rd and 74th Constitutional Amendment Acts respectively. So, the problem of local public finance will be addressed by introducing this consolidated fund for the local bodies. Now, to create a consolidated fund, certain articles in the constitution needs to be amended, and they have mentioned some constitutional articles like the article 266, which speaks about the consolidated funds and public accounts of India and also the states. Then your article 268, which speaks about the duties levied by the center but collected and maintained by the states. Then articles 243H and 243X, which speaks about the powers to impose taxes by panchayats and also regarding the funds to the panchayats and the municipalities respectively. The authors tell that through such constitutional amendments, the center and states should contribute an equal proportion of their central GST and state GST collections and send this money to the consolidated fund of the third tier, that is nothing but the local government. For example, if 1/6 collections of the center GST and state GST is shared with the local government, then it can generate more than 1% of the GDP every year. And this 1% GDP will be helpful in financing of public goods by the local bodies. So, this arrangement for decentralization will be the third pillar of fiscal federalism that has been proposed by the authors. Further, to strengthen the decentralization efforts, the authors propose that the state finance commissions should be accorded the same status as the finance commission. And next is the three epts of democratic centralization, which the authors tell that the three epts should be strongly implemented. The three epts are nothing but the funds, functions and functionaries. So all these actions would strengthen India's democratic framework. Next, the authors propose a model goods and service tax as the fourth pillar to the new fiscal federal structure. They have welcomed the introduction of GST but commented that the present GST should be modified to make it as a model GST or a flawless GST. They have given some suggestions to improve the GST, like it must further be simplified. Then the coverage needs to be extended to almost all the items that are being traded in India. Then single GST rates for all the items must be introduced. Then reforming the integrated goods and services tax that happens between the states, and also reforming the e-way bills. The authors have also suggested that the GST council should adopt transparency in its working. So how is it possible? Means they have proposed to create a new secretariat with independent experts and also independent staffs. So this will enable GST Council to undertake further reforms in a very transparent manner. The authors find this GST, the fourth pillar, as a strong pillar for holding the other three pillars. Thus, all the four pillars, namely the Finance Commission that we saw, then the second version of Niti Aayog, then your third pillar, the decentralization efforts, and the fourth pillar, GST, will all help India to create the new fiscal federal structure, and thereby strengthening India's unique cooperative federalism. Now, we need to know this term, what is meant by cooperative federalism. We know that federalism means separate governments at center and the state working separately in a very rigid manner. Like, there will not be much interaction with respect to the functions of the functioning of these governments. But cooperative federalism means the center, the states, and the third tier of government, which is the local bodies, especially in the Indian context, cooperate and work on the common problems. So this cooperative working model is called the cooperative federalism. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this editorial. Have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about the development of antibodies against the chikungunya disease. The analysis of this article will be relevant in your prelims preparation, in your current events of national and international importance, and next in general science. It will also be relevant in your mains preparation in your general studies paper 2 under the area issues relating to health. And it could also be linked to awareness in the field of biotechnology in your general studies paper 3. Now, this article talks about antibodies. For a better understanding, it is better to say it as an antitoxic body. That is, it is an agent that works for an effective immune response against a toxin. Antibody will be generated when such a toxin attacks or enters human body. So we can say that the antibodies are generated when this toxin comes. Therefore, this toxin is called as antibody generator. It is this antibody generator which is called as antigen. Antibody can also be understood as anti-foreign body. At the surface of the harmful foreign body, there will be certain proteins. These proteins that are in the surface of the viruses, fungi or bacteria are the antigens. Now, when these proteins enter human body, they generate antibodies. And antibodies will recognize, attack and destroy these antigens and protect the human body from infections and diseases. But what if the human body is not able to produce the antibody against a particular virus? In normal course, the person will be infected by the virus and the virus may be hunted down by the antibodies. Some viruses may even take the life of the person. But what if there is a virus for which human body is unable to develop antibody to give immunity response? Therefore, the researchers in the field of biotechnology develop some antibodies in the lab, and these antibodies will be administered later to the human bodies. Such antibodies developed will safeguard human beings from many dangerous viruses. One such disease is chikungunya. Now, know that this chikungunya is a viral disease that is transmitted by infected mosquitoes. So, the mosquitoes are the Aedes aegypti and Aedes albopictus mosquitoes. So, they are the main transmitters to human beings. So this carrier is also called as a vector. Therefore, this disease can also be called as a vector-borne disease because these mosquitoes act as a vector. Now, there are two main symptoms of this disease, which are joint pain and joint swelling. So you can observe pain in the joints and also swelling in the joints. Now, the World Health Organization says that this chikungunya disease is rarely fatal. That is, rarely this virus causes death. The news article states that an antibody against this chikungunya virus has been developed by an Indian institute, that is by the Institute of Life Sciences. Now, according to the news article, there is no prior antibodies available to combat the chikungunya virus. Now, let us see in brief about this Institute of Life Sciences. It was established in the year 1989 as an autonomous institute under the administrative control of the government of Odisha. Later, in the year 2002, it was taken over by the Department of Biotechnology and the government of India. Now, this is an autonomous institute of the Department of Biotechnology, which comes under the Ministry of Science and Technology. See, there are four antigens in the chikungunya virus, and they will be on the surface of the virus. The antigen names are NSP1, NSP2, NSP3 and NSP4. Now, we need not remember all these antigen names, just know it for knowledge point of view. The Institute of Life Sciences has developed antibodies against all these antigens. Of the antibodies, three are called as polyclonal antibodies and one is called as the monoclonal antibody. Now, you remember these terms, polyclonal antibodies and monoclonal antibody. For this NSP2 antigen of the chikungunya virus, a monoclonal antibody was developed, and for other proteins, polyclonal antibodies were developed. Here, mono means one and poly means many. So, monoclonal antibodies means they are developed from a single cell of an antibody, and polyclonal antibodies are developed from many cells of several antibodies. And the biotechnology fraternity states that it is very expensive to develop a monoclonal antibody, whereas it is relatively cheaper to develop a polyclonal antibody. Now, if the polyclonal antibodies attack different areas of the target protein or the target antigen, but the monoclonal antibody attacks or binds to single specific site of the target protein. So, remember the difference between the polyclonal and the monoclonal antibodies from exam point of view. Now, the news article states that the development of these antibodies will help in understanding the viral pathogenesis. In Greek, pathos means disease and genesis means the origin of the virus or a disease in this context. So, the new development will help us understand the origin and development of the virus and the disease. And this benefit is in addition to the empowerment of immunity against the chikungunya virus. Now, the team leader of this particular research team that has developed the antibodies has been selected for an award called as Biotech Product Process Development and Commercialization Award 2019, which has been given by the Department of Biotechnology. Now, have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This article is about the recent report of Office of International Religious Freedom by United States State Department. The article discussion will be relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national and international importance. Then it can also be linked to your mains preparation in your General Studies Paper 1 under the area Communalism, and in your General Studies Paper 2 under International Relations, within which it comes under your area bilateral grouping and agreements involving India and affecting Indian interests, and also under effects of policies and politics of developed countries on India's interests. Yesterday, we have seen in our news analysis about this report of international religious freedom, which was released by the United States government. We saw the two categories of countries. One is the countries of particular concern and the other being the tier 2 countries. There are two institutional mechanisms in US government working for international religious freedom, if you see. One report is given by the U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom, and the other report is given by the Office of International Religious Freedom, which is part of the United States Department. The report the news article talks about is the report that is published by the United States Department. The United States Commission recommends certain countries to be designated as countries of particular concern. We have seen this things yesterday. Now, the countries of particular concern means those countries that commit systematic ongoing violations of religious freedom. There is yet another list maintained by the US government that is called as Tier 2 countries. Tier 2 countries are those countries that does not require designation at present as countries of particular concern. But these countries require close monitoring because of the nature and extent of violations of religious freedom. Now, note that India has been placed as Tier 2 country by the United States Commission for International Religious Freedom for the year 2018. We also saw that several things were highlighted by the United States government that are related to the religious freedom in India. The report highlighted how the rights of religious freedom of Muslim and Christian fraternities affected in our country. Now, let us see today's news. Today's news is that the Ministry of External Affairs of India has rejected this report. This is very well expected if you see. Generally, there are certain things at the international level which the governments do normally. Rarely exceptions happen. If China brings out a report criticizing racial discrimination in USA, the US government will simply reject the report. Similarly, if US brings a report highlighting the persecution of Uyghur Muslims in China, then China will reject the report. Also, if Pakistan government is bringing a report criticizing the human rights violations in Kashmir, India will reject the report. Also, if India brings a report on human rights violations in Balochistan and Pakistan, Pakistan will surely reject the report. So these things happen usually. On 21st May, during our analysis, we have seen that India has rejected a UN report that dealt with violations of human rights in Kashmir. And India has also decided to highly reduce the relationship with the United Nations Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights regarding this matter. So, whenever you see such news, you notice what justification are given by the country to reject such reports. These points could be helpful in your mains examination to either support it or to take a stand against it. India stated that foreign government has no locus standi to pronounce on the rights of our citizens. That is, the US government has no right to talk or take the matter of how Indian citizens are enjoying their rights. The spokesperson of the Ministry of External Affairs has said that India was proud of its secular credentials. The spokesperson added that it is widely acknowledged that India is a vibrant democracy where the constitution provides protection of religious freedom. The preamble to Indian constitution states that India is a secular country. Also, there is liberty of belief, faith and worship. The articles 25 to 28 in part 3 of Indian constitution deals with the right to freedom of religion. The part 3 of the Indian constitution deals with fundamental rights. Just know it. The democratic governance and the rule of law further to promote and protect the fundamental rights in our country. So, a foreign government do not have the right to criticize how Indian citizens are enjoying their religious freedom. Because of these reasons, the Ministry of External Affairs has rejected the report that has been published by the United States government on international religious freedom, where it also dealt with India. Now, have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about rabies. The analysis of this news article will be relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national and international importance and next under general science. The analysis will also be relevant in your mains paper, in your general studies paper 2 under issues relating to health. The news article mentions that in the state of Karnataka, the government hospitals are running out of or in shortage of the anti-rabies vaccine, which is in short called as ARV. So, the patients are finding it difficult to get the life-saving ARV shots. The reason for the shortage is reported to be the poor response to the tenders of ARV which was floated last year. The officials say that the tender was floated or circulated twice last year and no one has participated in the tender. As there was poor response to these tenders, the government has asked the heads of the hospitals to procure the vaccine from open market. But the problem is that ARV is also in short supply, even in the open market as well. So, this is mainly because of the short supply by the manufacturers only. Hence, as a result of the shortage, the vaccine is not available in the primary health centers and peripheral areas, which is pushing most of the patients to rush to the district hospitals. But if you see, even there, the vaccines are not available. So, the patients are now approaching the private hospitals But here the cost of vaccine is very high, and in turn the patients are compelled to pay more. So in this context, let us see about the rabies disease. Now this rabies is a zoonotic disease, that is, it is a disease that is transmitted from animals to humans. And this rabies disease is caused by a rabies virus. This virus belongs to the Lysa virus genus within the family Rhabdoviridae. This rabies disease is an acute viral disease that causes fatal encephalomyelitis in all the warm-blooded animals, including man. So we have seen three terms now: acute, encephalomyelitis, and warm-blooded animals. Whenever we say acute, it means severe. And warm-blooded means having a body temperature that stays the same and that does not change with the temperature of the environment. If you see, the mammals, which includes the humans, are all warm-blooded animals. Then the term encephalomyelitis, it means the inflammation of the brain and spinal cord, which is caused due to acute viral infection. Now this virus is also found in wild animals and also in some domesticated animals. And this is transmitted to other animals and to humans through their saliva. But the most common host of this rabies virus is the domestic dogs. As we saw, rabies is fatal, or the one which causes death. Globally, if you see, more than 99% of human deaths are caused by dog-mediated rabies. In India, dogs are responsible for about 97% of human rabies, which is followed by cats, which cause about 2% of cases. Then even jackals, mongoose, and other animals causes this rabies disease. Now, human-to-human transmission of rabies through corneal or other organ transplantation is very rare, but it is possible. So know that human-to-human transmission is possible. Such transmission has occurred among the recipients of transplanted corneas and also among recipients of solid organs and vascular tissues in the past. Now, how is this virus transmitted from animals to humans? The rabies virus invades the nervous system of the mammals, such as dogs. Then it is primarily transmitted from the rabid animal's saliva to humans when it bites or scratches someone. Then the animal licking the wounds or grazed and broken skin, or licking the lining of the mouth and nose of humans, can also transmit the disease. After entering the human body, the rabies virus progresses from the innermost layer of the tissue below the human skin or from muscle into the peripheral nerves, that is the nerves in the body which are outside the brain or spinal cord. Then this virus migrates along the nerves to the spinal cord and brain. Next, the infected person exhibits behavioral changes as a result of this, and also some changes in the clinical signs when the virus reaches the brain. Now, let us see about the symptoms and signs of human rabies virus. First is the pain or itching at the site of the bite wound. Then this is followed by fever, malaise, or discomfort and headache that lasts for about 2 to 4 days. Then they also experience from hydrophobia, that is fear of water. Then also there is intolerance to noise, bright light, or air. Then the affected individuals also suffer from anger, irritability, and depression. So we can see a lot of hyperactivity. Now, if the World Health Organization says that at a later stage, by just the mere sight of water, it may provoke spasms in the neck and throat of the infected individuals. Now, the term spasm means a kind of involuntary muscular contraction, like in the case of seizures. Rabies is endemic on all continents except Antarctica, but majority of cases, like about 95% of cases, are reported in Asia and Africa. Also remember that rabies is one of the neglected tropical diseases. Rabies predominantly affects poor and vulnerable population who live in remote rural locations. Even though effective human vaccines and immunoglobulins, that is the antibodies, exist for rabies, they are not readily available or accessible to those in need. According to World Health Organization, globally, rabies deaths are rarely reported, and children between the ages 5 to 14 years are the frequent victims. We saw that rabies is fatal, but rabies is a 100% vaccine preventable disease. The countries which have started on rabies elimination programs have successfully experienced reductions in the rabies cases. And these programs have also led to the elimination of rabies. The elimination programs often revolve around mass dog vaccination campaigns. And in these campaigns, at least 70% of the dog population should be covered so that the cycle of transmission in dogs to humans is broken. If a person is bitten by an animal, the wounds should be washed and flushed immediately with soap and water for 10 to 15 minutes. And if soap is not available, just flushing with water only is fine. And now both these recommendations are given by the World Health Organization. And now according to this World Health Organization, this method is the most effective first aid treatment against rabies. In addition to this, the development of rabies can be prevented to a large extent if animal bites are managed appropriately and in time. In this regard, the prime importance is given to post-exposure prophylaxis or treatment of animal bite cases. Now, this post-exposure prophylaxis, in short PEP, is the intermediate treatment of a bite victim after rabies exposure. Now, this PEP prevents virus entry into the central nervous system of humans. Otherwise, it will result in immediate death. This PEP consists of the extensive washing and local treatment of the wound as soon as possible after exposure. Then a course of potent and effective rabies vaccine that meets World Health Organization standards should be administered. And finally, the administration of rabies immunoglobulin, which is in short called as RIG, if it is suggested by the doctor. Now, let us know about this rabies immunoglobulin. It is a kind of passive immunity which is available in the form of ready-made anti-rabies antibodies. Now, during our second topic discussion, we saw what is meant by an antibody. So, that will be helpful to know what is meant by an antibody. Now, this rabies immunoglobulin helps the victim before it is physiologically possible for the victim to begin producing his or her own antibodies. The rabies immunoglobulin has the property of binding with the rabies virus, and this binding results in the neutralization of the virus and loss of infectivity of the virus. This is important because effective treatment soon after the exposure to rabies can prevent the onset of symptoms and death. Now, in India, we have a national rabies control program. This program was approved under the 12th Five-Year Plan. Now, this program has both human and animal health components. We shall focus now on the human health component. This human health component is being implemented throughout the country. This includes training of health professionals, next the strengthening of surveillance of human rabies, etc. This National Center for Disease Control is the nodal center for the implementation of this National Rabies Control Program. The focus of human health component is on providing timely and appropriate animal bite management to all the animal bite victims. Since today's article is based on anti-rabies vaccine, let us see some kinds of vaccines that are available in India. If you see, they are available in different brand names like Indirab, Rabipur, Rabivax, Vaxirab, Abhayrab, Verorab, etc. So you cannot remember all these names because it is very difficult, but you can identify these vaccines very easily because if you see, they either end or start with RAB or RAB. Now have a look at the practice prelims question. Let us move on to the next news article. The final news article is about the Ranganathittu Bird Sanctuary, which is located in the state of Karnataka. The analysis of this article will be helpful in your prelims preparation under current events of national importance and under general issues on environmental ecology and biodiversity. Now, let us see about Ranganathittu Bird Sanctuary. This Ranganathittu Bird Sanctuary is situated in Srirangapatna, which is in the Mandya district in Karnataka state. Now, this particular sanctuary has 6 islands and 6 islets in the Kaveri River. The islets are the main breeding ground for variety of local birds and migratory birds, if you see. It is said that over 200 species of migratory and also Indian native birds arrive here every year for nesting and breeding. And it has also been stated that Dr. Salim Ali has carried the bird survey in these places as a part of the survey. Dr. Salim Ali had been a famous ornithologist in India, and ornithologists are those who study about birds. Now, islets are those islands that are very small, having little or no vegetation, and islets cannot support living for human beings. The islets of this Ranganathittu Bird Sanctuary are surrounded by water of a reservoir. This reservoir was formed by the construction of a weir across River Kaveri. Now, you need to know what is meant by a weir. A weir is a structure that is built across a river to raise the upstream water level and also to regulate the river water flow. Now, this weir was built when Kantirava Narasaraja Vodayar was the ruler of the erstwhile Mysuru state during the period 1645 and 1648 AD. The turbulence in the river has led to the submergence and erosion in islands, and this has severely disturbed the birds last year during the rainy season, particularly in the last 2 weeks of July. In the upstream location of this bird sanctuary, one can find the Krishnaraja Sagar Reservoir. The heavy release of water from this dam is also a reason for the massive damage in the bird sanctuary. As a result of the heavy water release, several trees were uprooted and many bird nests were just washed away. Now, trees are very important part of habitat for the birds, and if the tree population becomes less, then the diversity and the population of the birds in the region will also decrease. Some steps are being taken to increase the tree count and also to prevent soil erosion during increased water flow in River Kaveri. Then soil stabilization measures are worked out, and the State Forest Department has planned to widen the islands and strengthen the boundaries of islands with boulders. These measures will work against erosion during the increased water flow in the river. In addition to improving the thickness of the islands by dumping mud, the Forest Department has taken efforts to keep the mudfill bags as a protective layer for the islands and islets. Now, these are some of the preventive steps that have been taken by the State Forest Department for island reclamation. To increase the number of trees planted of different species will be planted. Know that birds are the excellent indicators of health of an ecosystem, and BirdLife International designates certain bird areas as important bird and biodiversity area. Now, this designation is based on international significance of that particular area for the conservation of birds. Now, know that there are four types of designation given by the BirdLife International as important bird and biodiversity area. The first one is A1. A1 corresponds to globally threatened species. That is, if a site is designated as A1, important bird area, then it means that the site has significant numbers of a globally threatened species. Then A2 corresponds to restricted range species. This means that the site will have many number of birds that are endemic to a particular area. Next, you have the A3 designation. This corresponds to biome restricted species. This means that the site has a significant component of the group of species whose distributions are almost confined to one biome. And finally, A4 designation. This corresponds to congregations. This means that the site has congregations of 1% or more than 1% of the global population of one or more species on a regular basis. Now, if you know that this Ranganathittu Wildlife Sanctuary is one of the important bird and biodiversity area that comes under this A1 and A4 designation. Let us now move on to the practice question discussion session. The first question is regarding antigen antibody. They have given two statements and have asked you to choose the correct answer. Now, we have seen in our analysis that antibody can be understood as anti-foreign body. That is, it is a protein that is working against the foreign substance. They have given the explanation of antibody for antigen, so the first statement is wrong here. Next, we saw that antigens are the proteins that are found in the surface of incoming bacteria or virus or fungi. Here, they have given the explanation of antigen for antibody. So, both the explanations have been interchanged. So, the second statement is also wrong. Now, the question is asked for the correct statement. So, the correct answer for this question is option D, neither one nor two. Moving on to the next question. With reference to Constitution of India, consider the following statements. They have given three statements. Now, let us see the first statement. The preamble of Indian Constitution states the following: We, the people of India, having solemnly resolved to constitute India into a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic. So, it does have the term secular. The term secular was introduced into the preamble of Indian Constitution by the 42nd Constitutional Amendment Act of 1976. Before the amendment, it was just sovereign, democratic republic. So, the words socialist and secular were added after this 42nd Constitutional Amendment Act. So, the first statement here is incorrect. Now, moving on to the second statement, we have seen in our discussion that the preamble talks about the liberty of belief, faith and worship. The exact line for liberty in preamble is liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith and worship. So, the second statement is correct here. The third statement, it states the articles 25 to 28 are dealing with the right to freedom of religion. Are they enforceable or not? If you take the Indian Constitution, the directive principles of state policy which are given in part 4 of Constitution are not enforceable. That is, one cannot go to court and claim that the provisions in the directive principles of state policy is a matter of right and the state should implement its duty under this directive principles of state policy. This is because these are not enforceable. They are just a direction for the government to take into consideration for policy making. But if you see, the fundamental rights are enforceable. So always keep this in mind, fundamental rights are enforceable. If a person feels that he could not enjoy her or his fundamental right, the person has right to constitutional remedy. The aggrieved person can directly go to the Supreme Court and the court will pass appropriate orders for the enjoyment of fundamental rights because fundamental rights are enforceable. These articles 25 to 28 is a part of fundamental rights and they are enforceable. Therefore, the third statement is wrong. So, here the correct answer is option D, 2 only. Moving on to the next question, consider the following statements with reference to rabies. They have given three statements. Here, the first statement is correct because it is a viral zoonotic disease, which means it transfers from animals to humans. And they have told in the second statement that human-to-human transmission is possible. The second statement is also correct because we saw during our analysis that human-to-human transmission is possible through transplantation of cornea and vascular tissues. Now, let us come to the third statement. We know that the rabies is transmitted by domestic dogs in 99% of the reported cases worldwide. In India, if you see, 97% of the cases are transmitted by dogs. And 2% of the reported cases are transmitted by cats. We can find rabies being transmitted even by bats, mongoose and even some other mammals. So the third statement given is incorrect because it has just given that rabies is transmitted only by. So the question is asked for the correct statements. The correct answer is option D, 1 and 2 only. Moving on to the mains question. India's fiscal federalism needs to be revisited and redesigned in the current scenario, critically analyzed. This question is about fiscal federalism. Mention what is meant by fiscal federalism, then mention the challenges that the states face with respect to horizontal imbalance that we have analyzed in our editorial. Then you can give suggestions to address the challenges like to give financial powers to Niti Aayog, then moving towards a more decentralized government structure, and then improving the GST regime, etc. Now, we can also add on any other relevant suggestions if you have studied any other news articles as well. The question asks you to critically analyze, so you can even have any points of appreciation like the current finance commission and like introduction of GST. If you have such points of appreciation, you can definitely mention them in the answer. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion and the practice question discussion session. Do like, comment and share the video and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.